Hi, good morning. Welcome everyone. We hope you are staying safe and well. My name is Gavin. I'm one of the client service team leaders here at Commission Factory, and I'll be co-hosting our webinar today. Our webinar is The Three Rules to Retailing Online During COVID and Economic Recession. Great. So, welcome everyone. Just going to kick off really with some housekeeping before we begin introductions and the content. So, for anyone who hasn't attended one of our webinars before, you do have the Q&A functionality in Zoom, and we will be collecting questions throughout. So, please do submit those. Also, I'd like to point out that if you feel you want to ask something anonymously, you can also do that through this functionality. Any unanswered questions will be responded to after the webinar directly with the attendee, and we'll be able to follow up in Zoom or over email. And then also, the webinar is recorded. So if you have any internet issues, I know a lot of us or most of us are all working from home. If you have to drop off for any reason, the recording will be made available around 48 hours after, so probably tomorrow or Monday. We're aiming for 30 minutes of content, 10 minutes of questions at the end. And yeah, just really excited to hear what James has to say. Finally, I'd like to just ask everyone for a small amount of participation. If you could just raise hand, using the raise hand functionality, just to indicate that you can hear and see us okay. Great, thank you very much. Excellent. So, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our host for today, James Taylor. James is the founder of Particular Audience, and Particular Audience is a Microsoft startup working with some of the world's largest retailers on both a SaaS and performance pricing model through B2B software and B2C consumer technology products. So, welcome, James.
Thank you very much, Gavin, and thanks everybody for joining. Really good numbers, so very happy to see that you've all shown up. Big thank you as well to Langton and my team for helping us put all of this together. It's been a couple of weeks of pretty intensive research, so we hope it's really valuable to everybody. Three rules to retailing online during COVID and economic recession. How to deepen your foothold and acquire market share in this downturn. Today, we'll be looking at retail economics, COVID, and its impact on retail. We'll be looking at macroeconomics, the broader macro environment, both now, current, and post-COVID. We'll be looking at data from consumers in previous recessions in the area called consumers in crisis. And then we'll move on to companies in crisis. We'll look at some data from companies in previous recessions. We'll then move on to how to thrive. We'll look at the different mindsets that exist in retail and specifically the opportunity that exists online. And finally, we'll close with three rules: how to adapt and how to execute progressive change. Retail economics. Spending is down. Discretionary spending, I should say, is down. But e-commerce is booming. Online retail is up 120% in Australia in the last month. So, quite a confusing time, probably, for lots of retailers, especially those that have a large physical store presence. Great for pure plays, and obviously good for some areas of retail as opposed to others. Looking at Italy, who probably farthest along in by sort of Western economy standards, we have had a look at the areas that are performing best. Everything on sort of buying things, fitness and gym, home office equipment, things to keep people busy, gardening, house cleaning and care. And we've also seen homewares and furnishings actually perform quite well. And we're seeing the same thing in the UK, sort of following the exact same trend as Italy. The same in Australia too. It seems that people are moving in waves through different product categories as they become relevant during lockdown. There's also been some verticals that have been more adversely affected, especially apparel, footwear, and accessories. I suppose if you are not shopping for parties and going out, then there's not as much demand for looking good. Same with things like party supplies, costumes, have taken a real hit in this. But it shouldn't come as a surprise. More people are online and stores are closed. Of course, e-commerce is doing better. But what does this all look like in a macroeconomic lens? What happens after COVID? So let's take a look at everything that's playing a role in the current unfolding of events. We've had COVID, we've had lockdowns, stock markets have collapsed, and there's also been a bounce, but we'll come back to that. Uncertain outcomes, there's ongoing intermittent lockdown as a possibility. Consumer and business confidence is down, investment is dropping off. Stock markets are now diverging from economic indicators. With a bleak economic outlook, we're seeing markets bounce. Don't know how long this will be sustained for, however. Economies are at a near standstill. Travel and oil prices have collapsed, which have deflationary impacts on things far beyond just oil prices. Corporate liquidity risk is high. There's a lot of companies that were highly leveraged that might struggle to service or pay their debts. And contagion is spreading. We're seeing knock-on effects into real estate markets, which are having knock-on effects into financial markets and so on. Government stimulus has come in and we've seen unemployment spike, especially in the US. And governments are stepping in to support jobs and businesses. But is it going to be enough? We took this data from McKinsey. They ran a bunch of forecasts on the type of recovery that we might be able to expect economically. And I think a lot of people initially were hoping for a V-shape, an initial sort of bounce back after COVID was out of the way. Unfortunately, that's looking less and less likely by the day. In fact, we expect that it will be a muted recovery, a drawn out recovery over 1 or 2, maybe 3 years. The crisis, this means, does not end with COVID. Economies will struggle to get back to normal. Consumer behavior will be different. Business models must adapt. Consumers in crisis, cool. So we've got some data from some previous recessions on how consumers tend to behave. And we think that this will be very relevant for each of you in looking at what you can expect from your customers over the next year or two. Physical retail contracted 35% more than online retail did during the GFC. For those that don't know, that stands for the global financial crisis, 2007 to 2009. This time, we think the figures will be more extreme. So, why did people shop online during the GFC? Well, thankfully, there were some surveys done across lots and lots and lots of consumers. And the number one reason for shopping online during crises was purchase confidence and comparison. The ability to compare deals, make sure that they've got the best price for different products. The second reason was best deal assurance. The number three reason was searching for discount codes. Number four was to save money, to avoid the impulse purchases of going in store, only going online to shop for items that they actually need. And the fifth reason was to shop at discount stores, group buying sites, etc. But millions of first-time online buyers are materializing for certain products. Millions of infrequent buyers are now doing so on a weekly basis. You've probably all seen this chart already. I think it's showing up in lots of different webinars and articles, but it's a gauge on the number of consumers that are digitally shopping for groceries more online. And you can see through March, this number in red grew week on week. In fact, in Australia, we're 23% up year on year. But these are not new trends, only accelerating. If you look at this data, we can see that over the past 4 years, purchasing groceries online has grown and grown and grown. Habits form and stick during periods of uncertainty. Smart businesses are creating or deepening footholds now. Companies in crisis. This is where we look at data from companies in previous recessions. We see what's worked and what hasn't. Harvard Business Review put out some research that looked at data from 4,700 companies across three recessions, recessions of 1918, 1990, and 2000. And the results are something that we really need to look at and listen to. 17% of companies do not survive. 80% of companies do not regain pre-recession growth rates for sales and profits in the 3 years following recession. 40% of companies do not regain their absolute pre-recession sales and profits within 3 years. That means they don't get back to where they were before the recession within the 3 years following recession. And finally, just 9% of companies flourish after slowdowns by outperforming their rivals. So how does marketing and recessions impact profits during the recovery? Well, again, we've probably all seen lots of articles that have said spending more on marketing leads to better results for companies. And during the GFC, we saw that companies that invested in marketing did see a 4.3% increase in profits during the recovery, as compared to companies that did not, who saw a contraction of 0.8%. And it's not just limited to the GFC, this data. We're also going to look here at the 1920 recession, the Great Depression. And it's clear here that even companies that increased advertising spend had a significant outperformance in sales during the recovery. Those that decreased advertising saw a drop-off. But is spending more on marketing a solution? Is cutting costs a solution? Well, from the Harvard Business Review data, we know that 79% of firms that cut costs faster and deeper than rivals do not perform better coming out of a recession. And we know that 74% of businesses that invest more than their rivals do not become market leaders coming out of recession. Finally, 85% of market leading companies before the recession will not stay at the top. So Harvard Business Review splits out the companies in the data set into four types. They look at prevention focused companies who simply cut costs. They look at promotion focused companies who increase spending and investment in marketing and R&D. Then they look at pragmatic companies who do a mix of both. They increase spending on advertising and they cut costs. And finally, they look at a cohort of companies that they call progressive. Progressive companies find the optimal or intelligent balance of optimizing between increasing marketing spend in the right areas, increasing R&D spending in the right areas, and reducing costs in the right areas. And just to give you an idea about the difference, I mean, promotion-focused companies do perform better coming out of recession than companies that don't increase spending. Promotion-focused companies see an 8% growth in post-recession sales and a 6% growth in post-recession earnings. But it's not as good as it could be. We look at the progressive cohort of companies that do an optimal mix of increasing spending and decreasing spending. And we actually see a 13% increase in post-recession sales growth and a 12% growth in post-recession earnings. So let's take a look at a real-world example. During the 2000 recession, Office Depot and Staples both behaved slightly differently. Office Depot cut workforce by 6%. Staples increased their workforce by 10%. Office Depot couldn't reduce OPEX. Staples contained OPEX and closed down underperforming facilities. Office Depot released an incentive plan to boost sales. Staples adapted. They introduced new high-tech product categories and services. So, slightly different behavior, but what were the results? Well, Office Depot's sales growth fell from 19% before the recession to just 8% afterwards. Staples sales growth of 13% after the recession was a whole 5% higher than Office Depot's. And Office Depot saw an overall revenue increase of 50% between 1997 and 2003, as compared to Staples, who saw 100% revenue increase between 1997 to 2003. And to boot, Staples was 30% more profitable than Office Depot in the 3 years following recession. This is more data from Harvard Business Review. Back to McKinsey, how to win in a recession? Well, focus on customer experience. This chart here looks at the total returns to shareholders of customer experience leaders and laggards. This is data from the Forrester Customer Experience Performance Index 2007 to 2009. And it looks at the top 10 ranking for customer experience and the bottom 10 for customer experience. And it shows a 3 times higher return for shareholders over the period of 2007 to 2009. So, address customer needs to prepare for the future. What can you do to address new customer needs? You can optimize your stock on hand, you can get your inventory allocation right, and you can ace digital product discovery. You need to reimagine the world. You do need to enact some cost cutting. You need to migrate consumers to digital channels. You can save money with this and boost satisfaction within your consumers. Reassess the utility of physical assets. There's long been a narrative about the changing role of physical assets in retail. Now is the time to enact these changes. Finally, build agile capabilities, acquire market share, adapt business models to accelerate growth after the crisis, and invest in machine learning and automation. Cool, so how to thrive? How to acquire market share? There are 2 mindsets in retail today. One mindset is one of scarcity. The other mindset is one of abundance. Scarcity mindsets are reflected by the likes of Sears and those victims of the retail apocalypse pre-COVID. The winners of the abundance mindset are the likes of Amazon, Netflix, Shopify, Spotify. Scarcity mindsets look at the rental cost of shelf space. Abundance mindsets look at the low inventory cost through warehousing and third parties and digital distribution. Scarcity mindsets are hindered by limited space. Abundance mindsets may as well have near infinite space. Scarcity retailing has to focus on best sellers. Abundance retailers can sell everything. Scarcity mindsets follow long hierarchical decision-making and ROI forecasting. Abundance mindsets permit experimentation and learning. Scarcity mindsets are top-down hierarchies. Abundance mindsets are bottom-up. I don't mean from the most junior people in the marketing team, I mean from the customer. They are data-driven. They react and they adapt based on changing consumer behaviors. And physical retail channels were far from perfect. They were dependent on often opinion-led inventory. They had to stock lowest common denominator items. There were assumptions around popular taste. And typically, individual stores at least, would often be subject to poor supply and demand matching. Physical retail is also relatively high cost for relatively low return. Store rent costs money in high footfall areas, and the cost of serving walk-ins is high. Stocked items have to earn their keep. They're occupying shelf real estate. That costs money. And finally, finite shelf real estate means limited ranges. There's only so much space that you can actually fill with items. So this has created a dependency in physical retail on a reliance on bestsellers. And there is nothing wrong with bestsellers, but everyone's taste departs from the mainstream somewhere. The more we explore alternatives, the more we are drawn to them. But don't take our word for it. Here is a look at the past 5 years, stock market prices for Shopify in black, Amazon in orange, Boohoo in blue, as compared to Walmart in green and Sears in red. The ability to grow and optimize and get the customer experience on right online is greater than it is in store. UBS published some analysis last week. They expect that 100,000 stores will close across the US in the next 5 years. They expect consolidation and the bigger getting bigger. Walmart, Costco, and Target could be among the last left standing. Here are some excerpts from that article on Business Insider. Coronavirus pandemic to have a long-lasting impact on the retail sector. The analysts expect the effects of the pandemic to accelerate a trend that was already in motion. The fundamental reason for stores closing down in the future will be the rise of e-commerce. UBS expects that many people will not go back to stores, or at least limit their visits. We think people will go back to stores, but we do think that they will limit their visits. Now, this isn't only because of new habits put in place during the pandemic. But it's also because there is likely to be a lingering fear around going to crowded spaces. So let's take a look at the long tail sales opportunity. So this is really trying to split up between the scarcity mindset and the abundance mindset. The head, or the short tail on the left hand side, represents your popular items, your bestsellers. You can see here that along the bottom x-axis, you've got products, and on the y-axis, you've got sales. So the head of the tail is your bestsellers. It is the items with highest sales volume. It collectively is your most popular products. The long tail of items are your less popular items. They are your products with lower sales volume, not no sales volume, but lower sales volume. And typically these are the items that are only available online. The sales volume in the long tail is actually greater than the sales volume in the short tail. So the revenue upside from stocking or making available more items is greater. So what are the benefits of selling online? Well, there are cost savings. You get your out of town warehouses, your distribution centers, you don't have cost of walk-ins. Having an unlimited catalog improves your odds of converting someone. You're able to serve more niches. And you're also able to provide a better customer experience. Now, I realize that's a sweeping statement. And of course, there is still a role for physical retail stores to provide a great customer experience. But the benefits of online retailing are search, reviews, recommendations, a consistent and intuitive convenience, being able to buy items anywhere, anytime, and to find those items. The long tail profit opportunity is also greater. The profit threshold for physical retail is high. You have stores that cost money in expensive places that are limited in the amount of space they have. For products or retailers that have a hybrid model that sell online and in store, that profit threshold drops. And for retailers that are digital only, that profit threshold is even lower. So, tiered pricing strategies, that is being able to price items differently as you go further down the long tail, and recommendation engines can drive customers to products they may not have found otherwise. So let's look at this in more detail. how to adapt, three rules for executing progressive change for future-proof commerce. Your long-tail market potential is twice the size of your best-seller market. The three rules are this. Number one, make everything available. Number two, get smart on pricing. And number three, help me find it. Make everything available. You can have more style variants, but you can still be selective. You can use data to inform what you should be retailing. That's trend analysis. It's identifying what people are looking at down to an attribute level. You can use data to inform stock depth and assortment, size depth. On smart pricing, you need to forget channel conflict. Online should be cheaper. People buy more at lower prices, and long-tail items actually cost less. But it doesn't have to be channel conflict because, of course, many of the items you stock online don't actually exist in store. Finally, help me find it. Do not become a mess of bad products. Lead with bestsellers from which further exploring can begin. Guide consumers based on their likes and dislikes. So, going back to an earlier slide, remember why people shop online during a crisis. During economic recession, the number one reason is purchase confidence and comparison. The number two reason is the best deal assurance. Number three reason, shopping for discount codes. But overall, people want to save money. So let's dive into these rules in greater detail. Rule number one, make everything available. I mean item availability, I mean stock availability as well. 87% of shopping journeys now start online. This statistic is pre-COVID. It's of course going to be higher right now, and it's probably going to be higher post-COVID too. But what are you doing with all that demand data? Consumers want to buy, receive, and return goods anywhere. If you are not using page views, searches, as well as purchases online to indicate demand for different items in different parts of the country to inform your order management systems, your inventory allocation systems, your stock planning systems, and any in-season reallocation decisions, then you are missing an opportunity. And you are adding further underperformance to your physical assets. You should be using your online data to optimize in store. So just to summarize, you can use that online demand data, of course, to optimize online journeys, but you can also use it to optimize in-store journeys. You can use it, which I think is very relevant post-COVID, for online to in-store journeys. In fact, buy online, pick up in store, or BOPIS, has increased 62% in the US since COVID started. And you're seeing even things like curbside pickup, drive-throughs. Retailers are adapting to utilize their physical assets in a way that complies with consumer demands today. But buy online, pick up in store is not new. In the US, 67% of shoppers have used it in the past 6 months. That was the 6 months prior to COVID. 88% of retailers are actually able to track incremental in-store purchases from BOPIS customers. Plus, retailers can save on shipping costs and cut down on fulfillment times through inventory allocation optimization. Whether you're allowing customers to pick up in store or whether you are shipping from store, you need to make sure that you have the right items available to allow that to happen in that store. What happens if you don't have the items in the store? Well, again, this is pre-COVID data, but $24 to $30 billion a year of Amazon's retail sales in the USA are attributed to consumers who first tried to buy items in the store, but the retailer was out of stock. That's 21 to 24% of Amazon's sales stemming from challenges in inventory management. You have a wealth of online data more so now than ever. You're able to localize that demand data. You're able to break down to a postcode level who is looking at what. And you can use that for inventory allocation optimization. You can use it to move items from distribution centers to different stores, between stores, from stores back to distribution centers. Rule number two, get smart on pricing. How to increase sales, cash, and earnings with intelligent and dynamic pricing. So this isn't all about discounting. This is actually really starting to think on a SKU level about how pricing can help you sell more items. Pricing, of course, you have your recommended retail price at the top. At the bottom, you have your margin that you're able to shed on any given item to turn a profit. But you also have what competitors are pricing at. And this can give you an operating range to be competitive. And prices can decline the further down the tail you go. That is to say that you can pull customers down the long tail with lower prices. Since long tail items actually cost less, you can charge less for them. Remember, even if they come to the site looking for a bestseller, do not underestimate the downsell opportunity. And to reiterate, since most long tail items aren't actually available in store, your channel conflict actually diminishes. Cool, so what do? We can develop an AI-based dynamic pricing model. This can start with a long tail module, which can see which items are less popular and which items might be competitive with your bestsellers. We can have a competitive response module, which is where price adjustments can either be automated or recommended based on competitor prices through our competitor website price scraping, price crawling. And finally, your elasticity module, which calculates how much a product's price affects demand and price perception. So you can have dynamic prices on qualifying items. Or you can use SKU level incentives, not blanket discounts. Blanket discounts are a blunt object, they're site-wide. Moving things en masse into a 25 to 70% markdown in clearance is not the end goal of optimizing your pricing. You can get down to a SKU level. Finally, rule number three, help me find it. Great long tail businesses can guide consumers following their likes and dislikes. If you like that, then you'll like this. Just as lower prices can entice customers down the long tail, recommendation engines drive them to products they may not have found otherwise. And this is key. The more items that you have, the less items will be found. Discovery becomes a problem that can be solved through recommendation systems. Recommendation engines are capable of finding the items in that long tail that are relevant to each customer. And just to throw some data at you from one of the particular audience clients that we're working with, we've just done some long tail analysis on their SKU base. And in the control group, so customers that don't see recommendations, just 16.8% of SKUs make up 80% of sales. But represented by the blue line, customers that do see particular audience recommendations, actually 33.6% of SKUs make up 80% of sales. And to boot with that, we've seen a 23.4% increase in sales overall. So the opportunity in your long tail of items is huge. And help people find them, price them effectively, and make them available. So very quickly, probably not too much time to go into this now, but there are obviously different ways to use machine learning to understand item similarity, to help move people down the long tail. On the left-hand side here, these circles are representing page views. This boot here has 250,000 page views. This boot here has 100,000 page views. And this boot here has 900,000 page views. The overlap where customers looked at both items in a session is something that we can put a score on. It's something that we can calculate. So we're able to calculate how relevant, from the wisdom of all of your customers, how similar two items are to one another, or complementary if you're using purchase data. But what if you don't have any behavioral data on an item? Well, this is where we can use things like computer vision or natural language processing to understand the similarity between items. Men's trekking Gore-Tex boot, men's boot hiking leather sole support, men's walking ankle support boot. There's some similarity in there as well. And again, we can put a value on that. And then we can look at each different customer. It's not just the item they're looking at now and what's similar. It's understanding what have they looked at recently, multiple items, and what are the relevant or related items to those. And that creates almost a universe for each individual customer. Coming back to that point I said earlier, if you have a million customers, you need a million websites. And this sort of machine learning technology is capable of merchandising your site for every different customer that comes to it. Finally, you've got this amazing relevance that you can have, but you can also use boost and bury functionality to meet specific business goals. You want the journey to be relevant, but you might want to prioritize high margin items. You might want to boost overstocked items. If you've got too much of something, of course you want to merchandise it more often. And finally, you may even be charging brands to increase the exposure of their items on your website in the form of sponsored slots. We can facilitate that for you as well. And finally, don't forget innovative approaches to search either. Of course, there's keyword search, which everybody is familiar with. But here's an example of me at Heathrow Airport a couple of months ago, of course, before the travel lockdowns, taking a picture of a bikini on a billboard and uploading it onto Spell Design's website. The object detection picks up the items in the picture, and we can then find visually similar items on the website. If your metadata is not in a strong enough format to permit keyword search, and you sell a visual item like a fashion or furniture and homewares piece, then visual search could be a really good thing to complement your keyword search. Great. Well, we're just approaching the end, and I think we are okay on time, run over a little bit, so I'll do this quickly. Key takeaways. The opportunity is online, so don't worry. We can still make good use of physical retail assets using online data. And to boot, we can improve the experience online. So, number one, make everything available. Number two, get smart on pricing. And number three, help me find it. Remember these three rules. Increase your chances of conversion, and you will acquire market share in this downturn. Tiered pricing strategies, recommendation engines, and inventory optimization is going to be necessary to thrive in a post-COVID world. Meet customer needs to filter your investment decisions, reduce spending on underperforming assets, increase spending on the right R&D and marketing. And I think to mention on that R&D piece, it's not a bunch of siloed digital tools that work. You need to start thinking about all of your data in a loop. You need to start thinking of your data as an ecosystem where technologies such as ours can actually work together using the data to achieve each of the different things in the three rules. So, quick view on particular audience. We're obviously specialists in search and merchandising. Specialists specifically in collaborative filtering, which is the behavioral led recommendations, computer vision, and natural language processing. But we also permit dynamic pricing. This can be within margin and related to your actual inventory of different items. We can help you localize data, liquidate unwanted stock, and reallocate stock as it's required in different places around the country. And using the computer vision and natural language processing, we can conduct trend analysis. We can help guide your design teams and your buying teams on not just which items are selling, but specifically the attributes and trends on those items that are popular. And it doesn't have to be a big piece of work. It might sound like this huge overhaul of your business, but in fact, it's actually very simple. Step one, You just need to track behavior. You need to get a tracking tag on your website that is objectively picking up the right information. You need to process item attributes. This can be done with the tag, but also with product feeds. Your Google shopping feed as it stands is already good enough to start this process. You need to ingest inventory data, localize it if it's applicable, if you've got lots of stores or lots of distribution centers. Then you can start layering contextual information on your website, similar items, dynamic pricing, SKU level incentives. Then you can meet business goals. You can boost sponsored items. You can boost overstocked items. You can boost high margin items. And finally, you can really architect a leading inventory intelligence solution. You can set up key reporting and action notifications to make sure that you have the right items in the right place at the right time. Cool. That's it from me. I believe that we have some questions that have come in. So I'll pass back to Gavin now. And again, thanks everybody for your time. And feel free to reach out to me directly at james@particularaudience.com if you want to pick up on any of the themes that we've gone through today, figure out how they might apply to your business specifically. Over to you, Gav.
Cool. Well, James, thank you. Really appreciate the detail and the sources. We went into a lot there, so a lot of food for thought. So thank you. I think it's encouraging that we're seeing Australian brands really already adapt and do some of these things. You know, I know the US source on drive-through pickups. I've seen a lot of brands doing that here as well. So brands are adapting quickly, which is really great to see, and I think they'll continue to. Let's dive straight into some questions, as I know we've gone a little bit over on the content, so appreciate that. One of the ones that came in is regarding discounting. So would you say brands should stay away from discounting at this stage?
Obviously, it depends on the brand. I think that the sort of bigger trend is that there's a lot of items that have gone unsold. That's less of a problem for evergreen items, but for seasonal items, I think that discounting perhaps is a solution to boost liquidity of those things. I think the cash is going to be important to retailers, already is important. So I think that the message that we're trying to communicate is to shy away from blanket discounting, and actually look to how you can use data and other data systems within the business to know how much you can discount which items, and a way that sits within a business that might be averse to having discounts, such as with dynamic pricing or showing discounts if it's more of a discount focused brand.
Okay, thank you. And moving sort of more away from discounting, this one's more product based. So someone's contacted us saying that as a business, they may not be in a position to integrate new solutions such as this. So what could they be doing in the short term themselves to improve their current position?
Well, I expect that there's a lot of retailers that are already manually looking at competitor prices, or at least manually updating prices based on competitors. I would obviously suggest that that continues. The agility of which obviously depends on how much sort of manual resource you have to do that. I think it's very difficult to provide a million websites to a million different customers without something like machine learning that allows you to operate at scale. But you know, I think that you could probably get up quite a good cadence of changing the merchandising as you require, especially if you have those business issues of needing to liquidate stock that's either running out of season or overstocked. And finally, I suppose on the inventory allocation piece, look, I think where the problems are most prominent, it's going to be obvious what's overstocked. And using your online analytics to make sure that you know if certain parts of the country or certain areas are particularly interested in different items to start moving stock as required.
Okay, so to continuing, I've got another one that's sort of regarding stock actually, so it's quite relevant and a nice one to follow on. So mentioning long tail products, does that mean that a company would have to invest in buying new products, or do you think they can use stock on hand that they already have or possess?
Yeah, I think that it's a good question. I think that it is going to be obviously key to optimize current stock on hand. So it's really using inventory allocation and product discovery initially to optimize what you currently have. But looking sort of medium to long term, the success of your online store is going to be based on appeasing all sorts of tastes and demand. And I think that once you have the infrastructure in place to stock the right items and help people discover the right items on your website, then that will actually give you the infrastructure to scale the inventory or stock or the types of items that you're able to stock from there. Yeah, definitely shouldn't be the other way around. You can't just add more items and expect it to be a helpful solution.
Okay. Great. I think we're going to pause there on the question front. So as usual, we'll follow up with a recording of this webinar. And if you do have questions, you can reach out to marketing@commissionfactory.com. That's marketing@commissionfactory.com. And if you have a current Commission Factory contact or account manager, please also feel free to get in touch with them. So really just want to thank everyone again. I think it's an interesting time. I'm personally very hopeful that brands and retailers continue to adapt and that we may see some bounce back spending in the future from consumers. And also I think James raised an interesting point at the beginning of the towards the beginning of the content, talking about how some consumers are infrequent buyers and now becoming more frequent buyers or first time buyers. So I think it's really interesting in how brands continue to harness these new users or more frequent users and get the lifetime value from them. So really, again, a lot of food for thought, a lot of detail. We here at Commission Factory will continue to work closely with our clients, affiliates and partners to monitor the situation and support as much as we can, especially online. Just really want to thank you for your attention today and hope that you and your loved ones are staying safe and well. So from James and I once more, thanks for joining.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Gavin. Cheers.